GearNetwork.com.
The following is a presentation of the Gear Radio Network.
I believe it's a big challenge for our building to keep things in perspective and to if we're going to get addicted to anything, let's get addicted to the process.
Let's get it on!
And with that, we welcome you to Trust the Podcast, powered by Better Live Than Dead on the Gear Radio Network. This is episode number 92.
Episode 92, babies. I'm back, bitches.
It's the Buffalo Bills at the Tennessee Titans. You can hear us on BetterLiveThanDead.com, GearNetwork.com, or wherever else you listen to podcasts. Also, stealing this one from John, make sure you hit that subscribe button as well to stay up to date on the latest podcast, John.
And that also helps support the network and the podcast. But yes, good on you, Ryan, for bringing that up.
I was going to say, John is at IMJCMoney, and he's joining us on the IndyCar Media Hotline. I'm Ryan Wolfe at WolfBLTD. I figured, John, I've said it enough, and you said it enough. I finally put it in the show notes.
It's about damn time, Ryan. And also, I want to give a very big shout out to Brayton for filling in for me last week on such short notice. I can't lie, guys. Bad mental week for me last week. Yeah, you know, I'm not looking for sympathy, but I'm just being, I believe in transparency, and I believe that maybe somebody out there might be listening to this podcast and might, you know, have those feelings from time to time where it's like, crap, this is just not a good week for me to do anything. This is, I can't right now. I need to step back and I need to just decompress. That was me last week. I try my best to handle those things, but last week, a number of situations got the better of me and I needed to go away. So thank you, Brayton, for covering for me. I appreciate that. And I appreciate you, Ryan, keeping the ship afloat in my absence.
Hey, it was fun. It was enjoyable. I was very surprised that Brayton responded to me on minutes notice and said, yeah, let's go now. So that's how that worked. But
that's awesome.
John, you're back. And for the first time in a while, the Buffalo Bills, we've got to talk about a loss.
It wasn't
a terrible loss. We'll get into that. But the Buffalo Bills drop a heartbreaker on Monday Night Football to the Tennessee Titans, 34-31. Wasn't for lack of trying, though. But Buffalo drops to 4-2 on the season. They still sit in first in the AFC East. One good thing to point out here, the Buffalo Bills – sorry, I had a pop-up here. I'm trying to close out. Uh-oh. The Buffalo Bills extend their NFL record by holding the lead at the half for the 15th straight regular season game. So I guess if you're looking for some sort of silver lining, there it is.
Well, I think besides that, the Bills, regardless of the loss, and obviously when, you know, history is going to look on this and say, on this day, the Buffalo Bills lost on Monday Night Football to the Tennessee Titans in Nashville. But I still feel that in reviewing the highlights and reviewing the notes here and everything like that, that this still was a statement game from Buffalo. Like, Tennessee really had to, and I'm not discrediting Tennessee at all, because overall their team is well put together, but they had to pull together in spite of Ryan Tannehill's less than stellar performance, especially in that first half. And they were able to do that. 10 years ago, it would have been a cakewalk for them. The Bills did not let up, and it was good until the very last second. Like, I mean, if you're going to lose, this is how you want to lose. You know, you don't want to be blown away.
Especially because of what we heard after the game, which we'll talk about here in just a few minutes. Mm-hmm. But I hear a lot of people, and before we get to the three big things, I'll just say this quick. A lot of people have equated this to the Arizona Cardinal loss of last season, where they had that heartbreaking loss. They go to a bye, and then they come back and crush the league. Mm-hmm. I don't think that this is of that ilk. I mean, yes, it was a kind of a crappy way to lose, but the way that the team rallied around itself, the coaching staff rallied around the players, I think, if anything, this is just going to show how much more serious this team is about winning. Despite the fact that obviously coming into the season, you knew that the Bills were Super Bowl or bust, essentially. But to hear Sean McDermott say what Sean McDermott said, which, like I said, I'll mention here in just a few minutes in our first of the three big things. It really opened my eyes where I thought to myself, wow, this team really is different. Like this is like you watch a team in baseball that's not supposed to be doing good and they're crushing the playoffs and you're like, this team has it. You look at the Bills and you're like, you know, this was a crappy loss because you never like to lose, especially when you're a good football team. But with that being said, it's all about how you build from those losses. And I think if anything, the Bills already seem like they're on track just by the post game question and answer that they're already on the right track and it's only going to make them stronger as a whole.
Well, yeah, but you take a look at the Buffalo Bills and how they are and how they've been performing for the, you know, the last year, even. I'll go back as far as a year because of the Hail Mary thing. That was kind of an anomaly. I mean, let's be honest. That easily could have not happened. Hail Mary could not have happened. The Bills could have been on a 11 or 12, maybe even a 13 game win streak if I think back far enough correctly before losing in the AFC Championship game. You know, that's a heartbreaking loss. That's what I would call a stunning, heartbreaking loss. I think this was a game that was blow for blow between two good teams, overall good teams, and it could have gone either way. I mean, despite how Tannehill played, the dude still has a good enough team around him that, you know, that he didn't have in Miami and a good coaching squad in Tennessee that he did not have in Miami as well. So they were good enough to adjust around his deficiencies, feed the ball to that freaking monster of a human, Derrick Henry, and work with that and work with what they had to come back. And now the Bills of yesteryear would have made a lot of mistakes. Josh Allen would have gotten very flustered and wore it on his face, but he kept calm. The team did their thing. They did their job and they nearly won this game. I think if this week and last week, I know we've already discussed the Chiefs one, but I wasn't there for that podcast. So I think when you look at these two games, you're looking at the Bills as almost in the same way I feel that you looked at the 49ers teams of the 90s. Or maybe those early Patriots teams, not necessarily the dynasty Patriots, but maybe, you know, the first couple of Super Bowls where they were a fine tuned machine and it was an any given Sunday kind of thing. In this case, Monday for Buffalo, but it was an any given Monday kind of thing. Like, this is not something that I think is going to start a downward spiral of suck that's going to vault the Patriots up to the first place while the Bills miss the playoffs. Like, no. This is just this team is different. They lick their wounds. They understand they're heading into the bye week. They know what they are capable of doing. They're going to get back to the drawing board. They're going to take a couple extra days off because of the bye week, and then they're going to get right back to work and do what they need to do in line for their next contest, which is, I believe, against I don't know off the top of my head. I don't remember off the top of my head.
The Dolphins
when they come Halloween. Back. Oh, the Dolphins on Halloween. Oh, yeah. Well, then
remember Squish the Fish.
Unlike that's right, Squish the Fish. That's right. Now I will say this: the Dolphins are going to be an interesting story to follow within the next couple of weeks if the rumors that have been circulating come to fruition. You never know. These are just rumors.
They've been strong rumors for a long time that Deshaun Watson is going to be traded to the Miami Dolphins. If it doesn't happen this season, it's probably going to happen next season. Let's
Now the rumor mill. I don't know if you saw in the chat that I posted. Yes, but the rumor rumblings is that a three-team trade, NBA style, is like in the works here, where it would send Deshaun Watson to Miami, to a Tagovailoa over to the Washington football team, and presumably somebody or draft pick compensations from one or both teams over to Houston for next year. So Houston would make out like a bandit in all of this, but either way, it's going to be interesting to see whether or not Tua will be the quarterback.
This is not the BLTD podcast, but Houston, to make out like a bandit, Houston would need to have adequate management to be able to make those decisions.
Well, right. Yes. Yes. I know it's not the BLTD podcast, but it is.
I'm just letting you know, because I would get lost on that, because I got a lot of feelings on that franchise.
Well, then maybe we should do a BLTD podcast at some point. But what I'm saying, the reason why I'm bringing this up now is because this indirectly kind of impacts the Bills, because who are they going to be planning for? You know what I mean? Right. Thank you, Perez.
can't do a real good impression.
That's a true story.
But you know, so this is gonna, it's going to be interesting to watch and see. But to go back to the Buffalo Bills, this to me, when they lost this game, when I woke up the next day, because I didn't make it through the whole game, when I woke up the next day and I saw the pressers and I read the stories and all that stuff, like, the only people that seemed to be really like devastated about this loss are the aforementioned Bills Mafia that I always make fun of, the small section of the Bills Mafia that I make fun of. They seem to be more heartbroken than the team itself,
which
took positives out of all of this, I think.
Which I'm just going to say, I'm going to end this opening segment with what we like to call in the business a bit of a cliffhanger, because we're going to talk about your favorite segment of the Bills Mafia later on in the podcast here. Because I wanted to make sure we got to it, because I don't necessarily disagree with you. But, John, we're going to roll over to our three big things, which are brought to you by PuckLuck.com, your one-stop resource for all your NHL sports betting action. PuckLuck provides win percentages and score projections for each and every NHL game to tilt the ice in your favor. Not sure what to bet or just in a rut? PuckLuck also provides expert picks to get the puck bouncing your way. Heads up, though, PuckLuck.com is in no way affiliated with NHL, its teams, or the NHLPA. PuckLuck.com provides data related to gambling and cannot guarantee the success of any suggested or related wagers. And as always, please gamble responsibly.
Well, Ryan, wait a minute. They can't guarantee the success of any suggested or related wagers?
I mean, right now with the Sabres, they might be able to, the 3-0 undefeated Sabres.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah, you better knock on wood there, because you might have jinxed it. Although keeping in line with my favorite section of the Bills Mafia, there's also a favorite section of Sabres fans that don't remember past November of a couple of years ago, when the Sabres were playing very, very good and entertaining hockey, and then it went.
Yeah, here's the other non trust the podcast thought. The Sabres are not better off without Jack Eichel. Shut up. Anyways, running down enough. The That's offensive fair. Stats, the first of the three big things here, wide receiver Stephon Diggs. He had 9 receptions on 11 targets for 89 yards and 1 touchdown at NFL Research. This week marks the first time that a player scored an offensive touchdown while his brother scored a defensive touchdown in the same NFL week since Vernon and Vontae Davis did it week 4 of 2009.
Never found that stat out. Again, Ryan, best in the business.
Thank you. I get random stuff that pops up on the internet and I say, bro, that's a good stat right there.
No lie. I've said this literally every week this season, and I need to reiterate it. I learn something new from you every week with these stats.
I try.
So that's awesome. I bring the funny, you bring the knowledge. That's how this works here.
I appreciate that. I got some All more right. for you. Wide receiver All Cole right. Beasley, 7 receptions on 9 targets for 88 yards and a touchdown. Did catch a lot of balls, did not catch COVID, though. Recorded his 500th
career catch. There it is. I was waiting for it.
He recorded his 500th career catch on Monday night, making him the 9th undrafted player in league history to record 500 receptions. Now we're going to talk about everyone's favorite quarterback, Josh Allen. 35 of 47, 353 passing yards with 3 touchdowns and 1 interception, 9 rushes for 26 yards, and 1 unofficial catch for a 2-point conversion, which actually I saw a stat today. In games where Josh Allen catches a pass, the Buffalo Bills are 0-3. They got to break that streak at some point in time, John. But Josh Allen's 3 touchdown passes on Monday night give him 11 in his first 3 Monday night football games, or his first Monday night three. Try that again. His first 3 Monday Night Football appearances passing Dan Marino, who had 10 touchdowns in his first 3 for the all-time record. Also, Allen's touchdown pass to Beasley before halftime pushed Josh Allen past quarterback, Green Bay quarterback Aaron Rodgers for the 4th most combined touchdowns, 108, in the first 50 starts of a career since the NFL merger. Also, Josh Allen is the only quarterback in NFL history to throw for 11,000 plus yards, run for 1,700 plus yards, and have more than 100 total touchdowns in his first 50 career games. Also, one last big stat here for you, or two last big stats, franchise record stats. Josh Allen moves to third all-time with 82 touchdown passes, passing Ryan Fitzpatrick, who had 80 touchdowns. Joe Ferguson next on the list at second all-time with 181 passing touchdowns. It'll take a little while for Allen to get there. Josh Allen is also 224 passing yards away from tying Ryan Fitzpatrick for fourth all-time in franchise history. Fitzpatrick had 11,654 passing yards with the Bills. Now, John,
that amazes me right there, because I feel like, and I know it probably wasn't forever, but I feel like Ryan Fitzpatrick played with Buffalo forever. So
it really did feel like it. Yeah.
Because it felt like, well, what was it like, maybe three or four seasons, I think, in total for Fitzpatrick between the bench and starting. I can't remember offhand. I'll have to look at that, but it feels like Fitzpatrick was, you know, I mean, it was Fitzmagic. It fit
2009 to 2012, so 4 years.
Okay, so 4 years. So that's I guess right on par there. But it feels like Josh Allen has done it quicker. But I think maybe part of that is the visual aspect, because not just does he have 82 touchdown passes, but he has XYZ amount of rushing touchdowns as well. So I feel like he's always scoring touchdowns no matter what. And it just feels like it's a rapid fire pace in comparison. It's crazy to see somebody come up and, you know, be on all time lists so quickly.
Yeah. And I'd have to double check too, but I'm pretty sure since Ryan Fitzpatrick, Josh Allen is the longest tenured Bills quarterback. And even before, that's why I feel like it felt like Fitzpatrick was in the the hell's going on here? He was in someone in, I'm watching the Red Sox game. It looks like someone in the bleacher bar had a cell phone light and they were flashing it behind one of the fences and it was causing a problem.
Oh, geez.
Anyways, it seems like Fitzpatrick was in Buffalo for so long. I think because before and after it was like a changing of the guard. There was always a different quarterback every season, it felt like. So having Josh Allen around, moving up the lists in franchise history, it's fantastic to see, because it's really showing you that he's really doing the damn thing.
You're absolutely right there, because I'm looking. I have the list up here. Fitzpatrick started all 16 games in 2012, and then he was let go or traded, one of the two. I don't remember. 2013, we had EJ Manuel for 10 games, Thad Lewis for 5, and Jeff Toole for 1. 2014, Kyle Orton started 12 games. EJ Manuel started 4. 2015, Tyrod Taylor had 14, EJ Manuel had 2. 2016, Tyrod Taylor and EJ Manuel split 15 and 1 respectively. And then 2017, Tyrod Taylor and Nathan Peterman. So Taylor had himself 3 good years playing at the helm the majority of the time. But yeah, since then, 2018, we had Nate Pete, Derek Anderson, Matt Barkley before it was Josh Allen. And then it's been Josh Allen ever since.
So to look at this, according to Pro Football Focus writer at PFF_Sammy says, quote, Josh Allen is 29 of 32 lifetime on third and fourth down quarterback sneaks. One of the 3 failures was that game defining play on Monday Night Football. John, this is where I allowed myself to move on from the game as a fan. Because obviously I try to take the fandom out of it and be more of a journalistic approach, not only with the podcast, but just because you shouldn't take sports too seriously, because they're at the end of the day sports. But
right.
Sean McDermott said, quote, I'll take Josh Allen 10 times out of 10 with the game on the line. I trust him and believe in our coaches and players. And for me, that did it, because I say to myself, look at, first off, there appeared to be an issue with the footing for Allen before attempting to dive forward. It looks like his foot slipped. It also looked like he may have gone to the left side when he should have went to the right side. Whatever, they'll figure it out. They'll make sure it doesn't happen again. Mm-hmm. But I don't know about you, John. My thought is that the Bills defense couldn't stop Tennessee all night. They were not able to, whether it was a short field or not, Buffalo was struggling to stop Tennessee. They were having a hell of a time with Derrick Henry. Mm-hmm. And I mean, in small spurts, they were having trouble with Ryan Tannehill, even though he didn't have an impressive game. But I would not have felt any better. I may have arguably even felt worse if Buffalo kicked the chip shot field goal and then went on to lose in overtime.
I don't know. I think that's subjective.
I think of it this way. Before I get your thought on this, I think of it this way. We talk about it all the time on the podcast, where the Bills have moved past the they need to win every game to put themselves in a better spot to make the playoffs. To the Bills are probably most likely going to be in the playoffs with relatively minimal effort because the AFC East is kind of bad aside from Buffalo. So my thought is it's like getting those practice reps in.
Right. Where,
yes. Did you lose the regular season game? Yeah. But you know what? You're able to put this on tape. So now you've said, okay, look, we've done it. And now how can we improve to get better so that this doesn't happen again? Or maybe, hey, we need to redraw up a quarterback sneak. So next time we know that we're good to go. Or, hey, you know what? Let's try X, Y, Z, 1, 2, 3, whatever it may be. Exactly like the Buffalo special, the copy of the Philly special, 2-point conversion where Dawson knocks through the 2-point conversion with a fractured hand. Mm-hmm. One of the situations where it's like, okay, you don't want to put the plays on tape, but also it gives you an opportunity to practice these things in real time. And yes. I think that is the most important thing, because not only that, but it's Sean McDermott saying, I trust you guys. I believe in you guys. And I'm not upset if we lose the game because we put the ball in our best players' hands when it mattered, and win, lose, or draw, at least we can say we did that.
Yes. And again, to go back to my point, that I made before you had mentioned all that. I think it's very subjective on that. I would have felt if he would have kicked the field goal and lost in overtime versus going for it at the end of this game and, you know, not getting it. The reason why I'm so okay with this and okay with the approach is I want to say I think it's probably the same reason that maybe the coaching staff is thinking. When you look at 9 of the next 11 games, Miami, Jacksonville, the New York Jets twice, the Saints, the Patriots twice, Carolina, and Atlanta. Like, the only two other teams that I didn't name are the Tampa Bay Buccaneers and the Indianapolis Colts. The Colts and the Bucs, I could see giving the Bills a major problem. But literally 9 of their next 11 games are against below 500 teams that with subpar play.
I was going to say, just jumping in really quick, I agree with that. Mm-hmm. And I was going to say there should be no reason why they have a game with the Colts before they take on the Saints on Thanksgiving. There's no reason why the Bills shouldn't be at least 7-3 or 8-2 heading into that game.
Well, I would give, absolutely. Like I don't see them losing to Miami, Jacksonville, or New York ahead of Indianapolis. Indianapolis, that's a team that could go either way. That's a team that almost beat them with Phillip Rivers and the majority of that same team in the playoffs last year. So Indy always plays everybody tough. I mean, if this were a schedule where all 9 of those 11 teams were at 500 or above, yeah, a win is something you need. And, like, you know, playing it conservatively, kicking that field goal, taking those points, and then taking your chances in OT with a little bit of a rest in between would have been probably the better idea for them to do. But given their schedule and given what's ahead of them and knowing what is ahead of them, team-wise, talent-wise, scheme wise, I don't blame McDermott for saying, oh, fuck it. Let's go. Why not? Like, realistically, if the Bills lose more than one game or two games rather, this season, I'll be surprised. I legitimately do not see them. I see them sweeping the division. I don't see New England beating them in either of the two contests there. The Jets are not going to beat them unless January 9th. But by that point, it would probably be a classic case of the Bills have the division wrapped up. They're resting everybody. And the Jets have all their starters out because they're getting them reps and no one gives a shit. Yeah. That's the only way I could see them losing against a team like the Jets this year is if they're resting the starters and it's week 18 and there's nothing else to play for. I don't fault Sean McDermott for saying, to hell with it, let's go for the win, let's gamble and see. What's the worst that can happen? We lose? Big deal. We got Miami, Jacksonville, and New York and right after our bye week. Like, yeah. For all intents and purposes, it's almost like an extended bye week.
Well, and it wasn't like the Bills had played a perfect game and lost. And this brings us over to our second of the three big things. The defense looked human for once. The defense allowed 34 points overall, which is their by far their worst points performance of the season. Mm-hmm. They allowed 362 total yards and recorded zero sacks, which I'm going to get back to in a second. Buffalo did record an interception. Jordan Poyer with a nice grab on a Ryan Tannehill pass. But Buffalo's inability to pressure Ryan Tannehill. Now, you can't really sit here and say like there's one reason why the Bills lost the game. But in my opinion, Buffalo's inability to pressure Ryan Tannehill was ultimately the issue in this game. Tennessee, John, had allowed 20 sacks in five games heading into Monday Night Football. Buffalo did not record a single sack against Ryan Tannehill. Just the inability to get pressure. And I don't know if it was because they were afraid of Derrick Henry or what it was, because again, Derrick Henry had a game. He has a game every week. If you can stop Derrick Henry, congratulations, because I don't know many people who have. I mean, I don't know if you saw the game when it happened or the replay where I believe it was Micah Hyde got tripped.
Yeah, Micah Hyde.
And again, it's just a situation where it's like someone's got to stop him. You got to put your body on the line.
Someone's got to stop Micah Hyde. If had a body language with a football uniform on, it would have been it would be Micah Hyde in that very moment. Like you could tell he looked at like he just was like, I'll trip him with his shoelace. I don't care.
Take the hit. It's going to hurt, but you're going to stop him sidestep him and he's going to score another touchdown.
Exactly. Like that was just, I think that was at one point I actually sent Brandon a text message after that happened. I was like, Micah Hyde did not want to be Micah Hyde right there at that moment in time. He was like,
The one thing, again, you know how they always say it, when you're on special teams, they don't want to know your name because then you know you probably did something wrong.
Right.
That goes for Andre Smith on Monday night. There was a 101-yard go-ahead kickoff return by Isaiah McKenzie called back on a hold by Andre Smith, which if Andre Smith didn't look like he needed to hold the guy, but he did just a little, even if Isaiah McKenzie got tackled, he would have been around midfield. It would have been a great start to a drive. Mm-hmm. The one thing I didn't mention, which I will mention now, actually I'll mention it after the break because it rolls into our third of the three big things here.
All right.
But again, when you're on special teams, if people know your name, that's a bad thing.
Right. Well, here, unless Devin Hester was on special teams. And
we talk about like, obviously Isaiah McKenzie, we know Isaiah McKenzie's like, he's doing great things because he's a really fast guy and he can really run the ball. He's got great vision and great speed. He knows how to take it to the house. I'm saying more in terms of like, hey, we don't talk about Tyler Bass much. Tyler Bass leads the NFL in scoring right now for kickers, but we don't really talk about him unless he does something bad. That's kind of the stigma that special teams.
Yeah.
It's like, if we're not talking about Andre Smith, unless Andre Smith fucks up, and boy, did he ever on Monday night.
But that's a football thing, because what does everything always boil down to? It always boils down to the position players. You don't, like you said, you don't hear about special teams much unless they do something bad. But like, you know, if the team wins, it was good play by the quarterback. If the team loses, it was bad play by the quarterback. Like, that's just what football is. But I see all of this, you know, everything you wrote here for the defense looking human for once, and it doesn't surprise me, because all of the good defenses, like, they, I don't want to say they crumble, because I don't want to give the vibe or the impression or the vibe that I think that this is it for the Bills defense. They hit their apex and then they're going to be normal for the rest of the season. I don't think that's the case. Again, 9 of their last 11 are against sub 500 teams. But what I'm saying is, when you look at, let's say, the Patriots back in 2019, do you remember they started off real hot on defense? They were record setting. They were like going to challenge the 1985 Bears for being one of the greatest defenses ever. And then all of a sudden they looked human. This is probably the same thing. Now, the difference, the big difference between 2019's New England Patriots and 2021's Buffalo Bills defenses respectively is The Patriots were on a decline. The Bills are on the rise.
Yeah.
So I don't think that this defense looking human this game is really going to carry over at all. I think the best is still yet to come for these guys. And with the schedule that they have, barring catastrophic destruction, I do believe their defense is going to be very solid come playoff times. So I wouldn't worry too much about any of this.
And a quick heads up too, speaking of the defense, they still rank first in the NFL in DVOA, despite the fact that they had an absolute stinker on defense on Monday night.
I mean, yeah,
that's how good they were.
That's how good they've been. I mean, they're allowed to be human. They are human. So they're allowed to be. What's going to be the big test for them for the rest of the season is, can they stay healthy in these games that they should easily win? You know, and that's the catastrophic destruction. Mm-hmm. And I said, barring catastrophic destruction, this should be kind of we should be in cruise control from now until the end of the regular season with Buffalo. Again, this is not, and I know we'll touch up a lot more on this on the commercial break, but this is not something that I woke up feeling like, oh, it's doom and gloom, it's back to the 17-year drought again. Like, no, this is just like, they looked at their schedule and they're like, okay, why not? You know,
it's a bump in the road. If they needed to win, they probably would have kicked a field goal. But then again, who knows? Because they weren't doing anything.
It's exactly what Bill Belichick and Brady were doing back in the early to mid 2000s when they could do no wrong. Mm-hmm. One game in particular that I remember, and I believe it was against the Dolphins, where Brady and, you know, they were just kicking the crap out of the Dolphins. And then Brady comes out, Matt Castle comes in because they were going to, you know, give Brady a rest and give Castle some reps. And what does Castle do? He throws an interception, a pick six. And then the next offensive series, Brady comes back out, takes him down for another touchdown and basically says, that's how it's done, son. That's pretty much where the Bills are at now. They can afford to do things like kick it to go to OT and try to win, or try to win now, and if we lose, whatever. Like, that's where they are now.
Yeah, I don't disagree. So we'll talk a little more. We'll wrap up the rest of the loss here on Trust the Podcast, John, right after this commercial break. How does that sound?
That sounds fantastic.
And we're back here on Trust the Podcast. As promised, the third of the three big things. How's that sound? Wrapping up the loss.
That now, also John, sounds fantastic.
I'm going to run through a couple things really quickly. First off, I do want to mention Buffalo did not help themselves out very much, giving Tennessee a short field on an interception, penalties. What else? There was something else that I wanted to mention too. I know there was a big pass interference call at least once or twice. So again, it was a situation where Buffalo did not do themselves any favors, and Tennessee just was able to take advantage of all the opportunities that Buffalo gave them and then some. So that's how you lose a football game. But John, the run game struggle on Monday night, anything to worry about or just a bad game? Now, they had 23 total carries for 82 yards, a 3.56 yards per carry. That was Singletary, Moss and Allen, I believe, were the only ones that ran the ball on Monday. Like I said, anything to worry about or just a bad game?
Just bad game. I wouldn't worry anything about it.
That's fair. I'll take it. Tight end Dawson Knox had another impressive game on Monday night, but NFL Network's Mike Garofolo reported that Knox suffered a broken bone in his hand against Tennessee. The timeline for the return is TBD, but quote, the hope is he won't miss much time, especially with the bye. He did have surgery on a fractured hand. They did say he'll miss a few weeks, but we'll see, obviously, when the Bills are back in the building. Did confirm, though, that Dawson Knox completed that two-point conversion throw to Josh Allen with a broken bone in his hand, which explains essentially why it was like a forward lob or like a shot put and not a throw. But good stuff either way. It's one of those things where Dawson Knox was a quarterback back in the day. So you're like, when was it going to happen? And it's just, you know, it works. But with that being said, another tight end, Tommy Sweeney, congratulations to him. He had one reception, one target for a yard and a touchdown. It was the first career receiving touchdown for the 2019 seventh round pick. Good for you, Tommy's Weenie. When I was a kid.
Attaboy, Tommy boy.
when I was a kid, the guy who played for the Royals, Mike Sweeney, mm-hmm. always cracked me up.
Why?
They would always go, now batting, Mike Sweeney. And I'm like, he said Mike Sweeney.
Mike Sweeney. I get it.
Thank you. Anyways, John, you were on the ball once again because I know you're always looking out for this stuff.
Hell yeah.
I don't disagree with you.
I love the troll, Ryan. You know I love the troll.
Oh my God. Breaking the fourth wall without getting into details. When John gets bored during the day, we get screenshots. We being myself and Mr. Perez in the Gear Network group chat. And I'm always like, what did John do now? And then you open it up and he's just tearing some random person apart. It's hilarious. Every time it happens, always.
Well, you know, the thing with those things is that they don't realize that that particular demographic, anybody that follows me that knows the type of demographic I typically go after, they're my Netflix.
I'll just put it this way for everybody that doesn't know or doesn't realize, I would say 9 to 9.5 times out of 10, John knows what he's doing, and he is specifically targeting you because he knows he'll get the reaction out of you.
Every once in a while,
John gets mad about something, and he actually passionately will yell at somebody about something.
Right.
But most of the time, he'll see something and be like, ooh, I'm going to have a lot of fun with this one.
Yeah, that is exactly that. If you're referencing the case from earlier today, that's exactly what it was. It was just I was out on the lake with a Miller High Life fishing, and I didn't even need to freaking put the worm on the hook, man. They were just – the fish
You were lobbing little sticks of dynamite in the water and just letting the fish float to the
and
top.
And, man, were they biting. and it was just fantastic. And the thing was, is I did it. This is a shout out to my late great friend John Huber here. He and I always connected on our intellectual trolling, and what I mean by that is we would and I still do this, but I take what they say, what someone says. And I will ask questions about that to draw them in. And when they come in, and that's they you can tell they start getting flustered when they start bringing in other subjects around, you know. So, for example, hey, the Buffalo Bills, I can't believe the Buffalo Bills lost. That's it. That's the end of this season. Oh my God, this is the same franchise that it's always been and blah, 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 blah. And then I'll just simply comment something like, oh, really? Why is that?
And I was going to say, what I was going to say to start this off, John.
Yeah.
Because I think it encapsulates the essence of the problem here.
Yes.
Bills fans can't handle the smoke. Don't act like an ass when the Bills lose because you look like an idiot.
You really, really do. And it baffles me when you take a team that legitimately, next to the Buccaneers, are the favorites to appear at the Super Bowl at the very least. They are the favorites right now, even after this loss, to represent the AFC in the Super Bowl. Like all of the sports betting things have that. Everybody believes that the Buffalo Bills are good enough to, at minimum, represent the AFC in the Pro Football Championship game. I don't understand for the life of me how anybody could see this performance, a what was it, 34-31? Was that what it was?
Yep.
A 34-31 performance, a 34-31 loss, that for the majority of the game, they were just slugging the hell back out of Tennessee. And the only reason why they lost the game is because they just simply ran out of time.
Yeah.
Like, I don't understand how you can, after majority of these fans were brought up in the drought era. So all they know is losing. And I try my best to give the benefit of the doubt there because I was around for the last glory years, the glass glory stretch, the Kelly era and all of that. I was around for all of that. And I remember how awesome that was. And when you live through something like that, and then you go through a drought, yeah, it's annoying. Yeah, it sucks. But you know that you were there at least once, right? And you know that if you get there again, it's going to be awesome, and you root for your team or whatever. But you know, for a small section of people that don't know this, like, they just go straight to doom and gloom, and that's when old Muscles Mufungo over here sits by and waits to see when people say things like, "Oh, I can't believe the Tennessee COVIDs are, you know, when or the referees are after Buffalo again," like. You guys just don't fucking get it.
Do you want to hear my 2 cents? Don't act like Patrick Mahomes' family.
Yes. Patrick Mahomes would be hard pressed to learn a thing or two from Aaron Rodgers when it comes to his family.
When your mom's on Twitter saying that an interception should be technically considered a fumble because the wide receiver dropped the ball into the other guy's hands, or your brother is dancing on Sean Taylor's number on the sideline, he didn't know, or your fiance's doing some wackadoo shit on Twitter. Yeah. Like, come on, man.
You know whose mom
that is so distracting.
You know whose mom I am sick of hearing about, but I don't mind seeing
that was going.
Zach Wilson. Mama Wilson. She is guilty, my friend.
That's fair. Hey, our look ahead. Week 7, man, it's a bye week.
She's annoying as fuck.
The Buffalo Bills are off this week.
Yes, they are.
So the Bills and us fans get a week to recuperate for the stretch run a few weeks away from the halfway point of the 2021 season. John, I'm going to say it for the first time on the podcast this season. If the season ended today.
Damn it, Ryan.
Which we know it does, and I had to fill the segment time with something, John. If the season ended today, the 4th seed Buffalo Bills would host the 5th seed Cincinnati Bengals in a wild card game. It's too early to talk about this weekly, John, but it gives us perspective when looking around the league because I mentioned important Week 7 games, and we got 3 of them. If you want to watch a game on Sunday, or if you're just itching for football, like a crackhead wants. The guy from, what was it, Tyrone Biggums, right, from Chappelle's Show?
Yes.
Y'all got some crack? Anyways, if that's you with football, Kansas City faces Tennessee. That should be a good one. Atlanta's at Miami, and the Jets are at the Patriots. I only mention those because it's the interdivisional matchups, you know?
Uh-huh.
So, with that being said, I don't know what I'm doing this weekend. Oh, yeah, I know what I'm doing. The U.S. Grand Prix is coming to you from Austin, Texas on Sunday. I'll be watching that.
Oh, nice. I'm
watching the fun championship fight between Max Verstappen and Lewis Hamilton, and hopefully we'll get some good action there.
Nice. Well, you maybe have the Red Zone channel on. That's what I did last week.
That's usually what I try to do. I'll throw it on my tablet because if I have it on the TV, it makes me feel like I'm on drugs, for lack of a better explanation. Right. I take my medication for ADHD, but you know, sometimes if I overstimulate, it becomes very overwhelming and I don't want to do that. So
No. You know, I definitely don't want to do that.
Yeah. I get,
don't worry. If there, I'll be watching plenty of football on Sunday. I always watch the Jets games, obviously, but, when even, you know, like last week when the Jets weren't playing, I had it on Red Zone all day. So if anything happens, that's like, you need to see. That's when I'll text you and be like, dude, check this out.
Quick, actually, the one game, let's see what Thursday night is, Denver-Cleveland. That'll be fun, except it's Case Keenum, which Case Keenum's not terrible.
He's not terrible, but he's not Baker Mayfield. I mean, that Browns team, you want to talk about bad luck. Holy crap with all those injuries they had, man.
Yeah.
That is rough.
I mean, looking down the schedule, there's Cincinnati, Baltimore. That might be a good one. Philadelphia, Las Vegas might be good. Houston, Arizona will be good if you want to watch Arizona beat up on Houston. Kyler Murray's a lot of fun to watch this season.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Tampa and Chicago and Tampa. If you want to see Justin Fields get eaten alive by a defense. Sunday night football, you've got Carson Wentz in San Francisco, likely against Jimmy Garoppolo and the 49ers. Mm-hmm. And Monday night, you've got Jameis Winston versus Geno Smith.
Oh, my goodness. Buckle up, America. That one's going to be a barn burner.
Well, hey, John, with that being said, I think there's no time.
Old-timey talk there, pop you there, Ryan.
Yeah, no time like the present to wrap this podcast up. I'm going to go work out, lift some weights, do some stretches. You do that.
I'm on a rest day today, brother, so I'm resting my muscles by drinking beer.
I'm halfway through week 7 of this program, so I'm doing good.
Fantastic.
With that being said, though.
Keep that shit up, dude.
Oh, yeah, I'm having a lot of fun. I am at WolfBLTD on Twitter. John is at IMJCMoney. As always, we are Trust the Podcast.
You're not.
We will catch you same time, same place next week with a shorter, abridged version of the podcast due to the bye week. But we're still going to show up. Don't you worry about that. Thanks again for tuning in. Have a great week. Enjoy the football games without the Bills. But as always, John, go Bills.
And gently tap that subscribe button if you have not done so yet.
I like what he says.
The preceding presentation has been brought to you by the Gear Network.